Our brand new series, Treasures of the Indus, continues here on BBC Four in an hour's time this evening. But first, the early days of home movies now, as a Scottish love affair with a video camera began.
For over 100 years, the people of Scotland have been filming themselves.
It takes you right back.
It does, actually. It's lovely.
Crumbs.
A lot of good memories.
Oh, yeah.
It's a little bit of magic.
Across generations, home movies have recorded the ordinary as well as the great moments of life. From our first steps to our furthest travels. Today we take for granted the ability to record our lives on tiny digital cameras and mobile phones. But in this programme, we look back to the golden age of home movies. Shot on cinefilm by our parents, grandparents, and great-grandparents.
Wow.
Wow. I don't remember ever seeing this before.
Unearthed from attics and cupboards across the country, home movies from the 1920s to the 1980s reveal an alternative, more intimate history of Scotland.
This is where I do the all my filming and editing.
In Edinburgh, 90-year-old Norman Spears helps people to rediscover their memories by transferring old cine films to DVD.
People have found film in the attic made by grandparents or uncles, and they say they can't show it anymore. And I've got various projectors of different sizes. It usually falls to me to try and do something with it. It does give them pleasure in being able to see films that sometimes they haven't seen for 50 years or more. Mostly it's been family films. We have had some people who've been very pleased with the work, because of the memories it evokes from being there. You get the same sort of shots in different families, different periods, 1950s, 1970s. You get the children on the beach, running into the water. They all want to jump over the waves as they come in, and they all have fond memories of it.
It's so important to make someone happy. Make just one someone happy. Make just one heart to heart you. You sing to one smile that cheers you. One face that lights when it nears you. One girl you're everything to.
Whilst photographs capture individual moments, it's these films of family and friends doing things together that most movingly evoke our memories. They show us how much our lives have changed and how much has stayed the same. Home movies and the treasures they hold date back to before Norman was even born. Throughout the 20th century, advances in cinema technology meant that more and more people could record their lives and loves. By the mid-1960s, almost anyone could make a movie. These days, we take for granted the ability to film ourselves on phones and digital cameras, but there was a time when moving pictures seemed like magic. This is Glasgow's Great Western Road on a typical Sunday morning in 1914. But early cine cameras were hand-cranked, mechanical and cumbersome. They were also expensive. Too expensive for all but the most wealthy.
The Isle of Arran belonged to my mother. She had this place and Eastern Park in Suffolk, but I only knew this one.
This is Lady Jean Ford and her father, the Duke of Montrose. Her mother, Lady Mary, was a keen photographer and a pioneer home movie maker. She began recording family life around their home, Brodick Castle, in the mid-1920s.
That's me with long hair. This is our little boat called the Crewman, and we got pulled along. It was really too slow to try and do that. It capsized very easily. Oh, I'm go down, sure to go down there. We bathed from the 30th of May till the 30th of September every day. It's supposed to be good for us. Father and the Queen, I think, Aunt Nellie, and your Queen Mother, there you are. And the King, or, you know, Albert. And the King and Queen came up for a football match in Glasgow and stayed with us while they were there. It is amazing to think that we all wore hats every time we went out in the garden. Isn't it amazing? Dancing in Brodick Games.
Lady Jean was the youngest of four siblings by 8 years. With her brothers and sisters away at boarding school, she spent much of her childhood alone or with her aging nanny.
I couldn't go to school because I'd had tuberculosis. That illness that really put me back, you know, I had to be in bed every evening about 9 o'clock. I had a governess, I did lessons outside if it was sunny. I really very seldom had anyone to play with, so it was lonely. One learned to occupy oneself because Mother's great saying, if you said you were bored, was that boredom is a sign of lack of intelligence. So it didn't really take you very long to get something to do.
I dream of Jeannie with a light brown hair, born like a vapor on the summer air.
I was born 94 years ago, 1920. I'm glad to have seen the great British Empire, the greatest since the days of the Romans, and we won't ever see the like again.
The British Empire of Lady Jean's childhood was at its peak, ruling over one-fifth of the world's population and almost a quarter of its landmass. It was a great time to be part of the aristocracy, eager to leave behind the horrors of World War I. Britain was embracing modernity in art and design, experimenting with technology, and dancing to the new and exciting jazz music. But the vast majority of the country still didn't even have electric light. They certainly couldn't indulge in the expensive hobby of making home movies. Unless, that was, they ran a camera shop.
Here we go. July 1926, and there me. My father had a photographic shop at that time. It was a family business, and he used cameras that may have been a problem with them, and he would take the cameras home, shoot some film on them just to check whether they worked or not. And so that was where the early family film came from. And that covered the early black and white stuff, which was taken in Mid-Stockett Road in Aberdeen, and I was just a nipper.
Alan's father's home movies give a rare insight into the life of an Aberdonian family in the 20s.
The fashions of the time were something else. Beehive hats for ladies and long dresses, white stockings. I've got what looks like a little dress on, which is... let's say no more about that. Oh. Now there's my father, my goodness, and a silhouette of my mother, and a little pirouette in the road. I wish I could remember more about it. My memory is through the film. I certainly don't remember any of that. Bonzo the dog. Goodness gracious. He was a lovely dog. Hey-ho, where did that come from? Yeah. Things you remember. This is what a lot of the original film was shot with. This is a camera called the Cine Kodak Special. It's quite heavy. It was bought new and used by my dad's company. I can't tell you how many thousand feet of film it's shot in its lifetime, and it still runs like a clock. But oh, this is a good old friend, and I wouldn't part with it. It's lovely.
Throughout the 20s and 30s, attempts were made to bring colour to motion pictures. This is a rare example of a complicated process called Duffy colour, which failed to catch on. Then, in the mid-1930s, Kodachrome was launched to instant and commercial success. Whilst the majority of feature films were still being released in black and white, it was now possible for ordinary people to capture their world in colour. With the arrival of colour and cheaper, more user-friendly cameras, the home movie market grew, and the tradition was passed down through the generations.